people still waiting outside, so we'll just be respectful when they come in and kind of just make sure there's a seat for them. So, hello everybody, and welcome to our 2015 media panel hosted by the Society of Professional Journalists and the Robert Williams University Career Center. My name is Stephanie Ressler, and I will be your moderator tonight. I am a fourth-year journalism major, and I'm the president of the Society of Professional Journalists. But enough about me, let's get on to meet our very accomplished group of panelists. So first, we are really excited to welcome back two STAR alumni, also SBJ alumni, who have succeeded in the field of journalism since their very recent graduations. We have Chris Ferreira and Sam Robleski. Let's give them a hand. And we also have Chris Hofstetter, Patrick Little, and Nicole DeRosier. Let's give them also a round of applause. Alright, so let me introduce our panelists. First, we have Chris Ferreira, a 2014 graduate of the journalism program, and has worked in TV since then. He currently works as a morning producer with 7 News, the NBC affiliate in Boston, where he produces their 9 a.m. hour of Today in New England. Then we have Sam Robleski. He is a local broadcast journalist and 2013 graduate of the communications department. Since his graduation, he worked in both television and radio, and most recently as the digital editor for the leading news talk station, 630 WPRO. And a huge congratulations to Sam. In just a few days, he will begin his next journey as the inaugural digital reporter for NBC 10 News. Congratulations. All right, here we have Chris Hofstetter. His name tag was not printed, so just remember his name. That's Chris H. He is a creative manager and senior writer in Oxfam America's Department of Communications in the organization's headquarters in Boston. He works with the staff writers and designers to produce material for Oxfam America's website and publications. We have Patrick Little. He is the weekday morning news anchor for Eyewitness News This Morning and Eyewitness News at Noon on WPRI and Fox Providence. He has been working at WPRI since 1998. And was previously the sports director for 10 years before becoming the morning news anchor. And we have Nicole DeRosier. She is the producer for the ABC Boston affiliate WCBB. She works on the program City Line, which focuses on issues affecting communities of color. She has been with WCBB for 5 years, working under the community affairs umbrella, spending time in Chronicle, and now coordinating their intern intake. So those are our panelists, everybody. So let's get right into the question portion. But first, let's let people get in here. You guys can come right ahead. Don't worry about it. Come on in. There's plenty of room. Seats right up front. Also, they won't
I know what you're trying to do. Sit in the back. I did the same thing. Come right down in front. I have a question for everybody.
All right. Start off.
I got a question.
Started off with a question.
Where were you guys in 1998 when I started at Channel 12?
4 years old.
All right. Just break the ice with that.
All right. Once everybody's seated, we'll start with our first question. And our first question is for our alumni, Chris Ferreira. Chris, you started your career in Montana, then you ended up in New Hampshire, and now you landed in Boston. What has your post-grad experience been like? And talk about the transition from working in a really small TV market to now in a top 10 market.
Yeah, it's been ridiculous, I guess is a good word. Coming from New England, which is pretty populous, you know, a lot going on. I went to Montana 6 days after graduating here from Roger Williams last May. And it was just like a different country. Like, I had no idea where I was. There's moose running around, there's bears everywhere. It was totally crazy. But it was great to get my feet wet. I actually went out there, I'm a producer now, but I started as a reporter. So I was reporting out there 5 days a week on whatever pops up. And in Montana, that could be anything from a murder to a bear attack to a car accident, anything. So that was a really great opportunity to go just straight out there from college, jump right into things, get my feet wet. And like Stephanie said, I went to New Hampshire after that, got offered a producing opportunity at a news station there. Just a totally different news market to work in, obviously with the presidential election coming up. Politics are huge in New Hampshire, so I did a lot of politics, a lot of live interviews on my show and stuff. Kind of your more day-to-day, pretty similar to Rhode Island, just stuff you can see in the news. And then I went from there to Boston this past July, which is like a totally different beast. Breaking news nonstop. I produced the 9 a.m. hour usually, so there's usually some sort of car accident or something breaking during my show. You never know what's going to happen. So I went from Montana, where there's nothing happening, to Boston, where there's too much happening, and I have too much news in my show, and I have to figure out, you know, what I want to put in and what I want to take out. So the transition has been kind of crazy. I got to see a little bit of everything, a little bit of every market.
Thank you. So you have some more people filing in. Welcome, guys. All right, our next question is for Sam. Sam, you worked in radio for the past few years since you graduated, and now you are heading into TV. What made you make that decision?
Actually, my career started in TV. In my senior year, I had been interning over at Channel 12, where I'd actually met Patrick before. And towards the end of that internship, someone ended up leaving, and there was a part-time position available. So, being the studious young man, I just jumped right into that, and I was working 3 a.m. shifts on the weekend during my college career, which is not recommended if you want to be a healthy person. So from there, I was on a producing track, except it was only part-time even after I graduated. And at that time, I was at a crossroads of, do I, you know, look for something else? Do I get a part-time job to go with this part-time job, when the radio gig opened up as a digital editor / reporter for the leading talk news station in the state, WPRO. And a lot of that was turn over a lot of copy from the reporters, turn that into a usable web story. Eventually that transitioned into doing some live work, some amount of pre-recorded radio work. The highlight, I think, of my time there was during the Black Lives Matter protests that spilled over and shut down I-95. I was there that night covering that, and I got to do the live hits from that. So I got to bite the bug and do a little bit of reporting, and that is a really, really addicting feeling. For any of you who gets to move on in the future and do a little bit of reporting, you're going to find when you're chasing up a lead and you're following up on something and you know you almost have it, just that feeling of anticipation, there's a bit of a high that goes with it. You can't quite replicate that with anything else. I'm sure if you're producing and everything goes off without a hitch after something broke, I'm sure you have like the exact same feeling, but I just couldn't shake that, and that job and this job I'm working now just didn't have enough of it. So when I saw that Channel 10 had something opened up in their digital side, they were expanding that department, there was the opportunity to report and follow up on my own leads, kind of get my, get my hands dirty in the Rhode Island market even more, and it's not an opportunity you can pass up. So put that hat in the ring, and you know, looks like I was selected to do that, so on to the future, I guess.
All right, thank you so much. And our next question is for Chris H. Chris, you have written and produced videos on projects from all over the world, some of which include Ethiopia, Guatemala, El Salvador, Bolivia, Haiti, Vietnam, Honduras, Cambodia, Peru, Zimbabwe, the list really goes on, and many others. So what is it like traveling for your job, and what is one of the most remarkable stories that you experienced in these endeavors?
I don't think we have enough time for that, but so first of all, international reporting comes with a lot of very unusual challenges, we'll say, ranging from cutting across cultures and languages. Sometimes the logistics are just mind-boggling. If you can get to where you intend to go and you can talk to the person who you intend to meet with on any day at all, it's sometimes quite a good day. I don't know, I've had a lot of weird stuff happen. You know, I got stuck in Haiti for 3 days. I was supposed to leave the day of an election, a preliminary sort of presidential election about 10 months after the earthquake there in 2010, and had some logistical problems, and before I could get out of the country, they shut down the airport and just everything. There was a lot of violence, and I was stuck in a house for 3 days, just like trying to hope nobody saw me there. You know, I wasn't in any danger, but it was just super inconvenient. And of course, everybody at headquarters all flipped out and didn't know where I was, and you know, so that was fun. Go to some really bizarre, super remote places, and like up along the border with Cambodia and Laos and Vietnam, up in the corner there. So really. Very diverse indigenous communities there, facing some very unusual political, environmental, and various types of social problems, and trying to figure out how to translate that into a video or a story that people here will relate with. I work with a lot of specialists, like practitioners in community and community development, and many of them are like social scientists, and the way that they communicate about their work is not conducive for somebody like me, who has a background as a journalist, who, you know, wants to speak in very plain language. So there's a lot of challenges that go along with that. And yeah, I'll have to reflect on the craziest story. You know, Haiti's up there, but you know, I had some very unusual experiences working in Nigeria just this past June, in an area that has recovering from a very serious conflict down in the Niger Delta, and trying to just get access to a community and negotiate, you know, the privilege to go and talk with people there, with the chiefs who all wanted money and, you know, lots of things that I couldn't provide to them. So there's a lot of bizarre sort of negotiation that goes on with in a lot of the communities where I have to work. But I can talk about that stuff more later if there's time.
All right, yeah. I think a lot of people are going to want to probably chat with you after the panel. So
sure.
If you think of any more, feel free to share them. We'd love to hear them. All right, so the next question is for Patrick. So a lot of people here are interested in breaking into the competitive sports industry, which you were in for many years before becoming the news anchor. What tips do you have for young journalists that are trying to break into sports journalism, and why did you leave sports and move on to hard news?
For you folks that are thinking about getting into television in general, the first piece of advice I will give you is ramen noodles. And the reason I say that is the journey to, and these folks up here can probably relate as well, the journey to a, I don't want to say successful career, but where you're not eating ramen noodles is a tough one. Like he went to Montana, right? I mean, you know, I started my career in Manchester, New Hampshire, and it was in 1994, right out of college. I was like super intern, and I went into this TV station in Manchester. I went to St. Anselm College, kind of like Roger Williams, sort of the same size. And I did an internship, and I was just like a mosquito. I would not leave these people alone. I would not leave the building. I would just be there 5-7 days a week. I interned after I graduated from college 7 days a week. I mean, I really wanted the job. So that's how I got into the industry. Well, I was a business major in college, and then I went into intern. I became like a professional intern. And how I got into it was I was just hanging around, and I would suggest to anybody, and Stephanie can tell you, that if you do an internship, it's kind of like a, it's like a scholarship to grad school, because you're at a TV station or a radio station or newspaper, and you're hands-on, and you're helping out probably more than you thought you would when you got there. So I got the job in September of 1994. Anybody want to guess what my salary was my first year in television in 1994? Someone just raise their hand and just throw it. Yeah.
$40,000.
$17,000. Yeah, no. Anyone else? It's going to get embarrassing.
$10,000.
$13,000 a year. I'm like, wait a second. I pay four times that amount to go to school here for a year. It's $414 every 2 weeks after taxes. It was New Hampshire, so they don't have income taxes. I mean, there's no taxes up there, so that's a good place to work. So the point is that when you get into it, be prepared to really want to enjoy it. And I don't speak just for television, it's the same for radio. And until you get to the market that you hopefully get to, you'll see the rewards for your hard work. And my scary story is, not quite as scary as yours, but the first time I was on television, September 21st, 1994, I did a halftime report for a UNH football game. My first time on live TV. I mean, I practiced this 2-minute live broadcast the night before. I picked out my suit the night before. I mean, I was ready. And I went on TV, that little red light came on, and I went and I talked, and I sounded like Mickey Mouse. I flew through this 2-minute thing. The light went off, and I threw up in a trash can underneath the anchor desk. So I called my dad. He's like, how'd it go? It went great. He's like, well, tell me about it. I said, you know, this, and I said, yeah, I threw up. He goes, wait a second. They're paying you $13,000 a year, and you're getting sick at your job. Are you sick? Like, do you want to, what are you doing? Well, I haven't thrown up since. That was a long time ago, so 21 years, right? 24. And then I went from Manchester to Providence. I got hired in 98. I was doing sports the whole time. And the sports thing is, I was a college athlete, but at 5'9 and 165 pounds, unless they had openings for jockeys, I was not going to play pro lacrosse.
It just was not going to happen, or pro soccer, or be a professional skier. So I said, I want to get into something that is a little bit different than what my friends are doing, maybe, and you know, that are into finance or working at Enterprise Rent-A-Car. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But so that was my goal. Was that I can't be a pro athlete. I want to try and be hanging out in locker rooms and being around these athletes and traveling around the country. And long story short, I did sports for 16 years. Been to 5 Super Bowls, 3 World Series, NBA Finals, Stanley Cup Finals, Ryder Cup, Daytona 500s, on and on it goes. Just a lot of cool things, NCAA tournaments. And then 5 years ago, I got offered the job to be the morning news anchor. And as some of these folks will relate, that a lot of sports anchors are making the transition to do more, to do the news. So now I get up at 3 o'clock in the morning every day. You only had to do it twice a week. 3 o'clock in the morning every day. So I'll answer more questions about it, but that's how a little snapshot of my puking into success. And I still eat ramen noodles, by the way. This is easy.
Thank you. Yep. All right. Our next question is for Nicole. Nicole, so you work for Community Affairs, and you are dealing with internship applications. So I know a lot of students here are really interested in working and interning at WCVB in Boston. So could you share with us what makes a good applicant, and what are some immediate red flags that you would see in an application?
A McDonald's job. We all have to work, so I totally understand that, and a lot of the TV internships are unpaid. But we also want you to have experience on your application, on your resume, that is going to reflect, you know, experience that you can grow while you're there at Channel 5 or any other station or radio station. So like I said, you know, as much as you gotta get paid, your, you know, burger flipping skills aren't really gonna be applicable when we need you in the newsroom. So I would just say the volunteering and the internships and the coursework are gonna look a lot better than extremely irrelevant job experience. That's a red flag for, I mean, I look at them all the time. That's a huge red flag for me. Grammar. We're in journalism, so I hope that, you know, everyone can write. Other than that, it's the experience, or taking the coursework that you have, whether you don't have as much experience, and just flipping that and showing us how you're interested and how you kind of want to use what you already have to learn more. We want to know that you want to learn. Or Barnes & Noble's, like McDonald's. I mean, I don't want to hate on McDonald's.
All right, well, thank you. So now we're going to go back to Chris F. So as you mentioned before, your first job was as a news reporter, and now you're producing. Is there a reason that you switched into producer? Is there one that you prefer over the other? If so, why?
Yeah, to be honest, I just kind of got curious, and I just wanted to see what producing was all about. Reporting is a lot of fun, but it is a lot of work, and you're out constantly, especially in Montana. I was a one-man band, which means I not only, you know, thought of story ideas in the morning, I had to go out and shoot all the video myself. I had to do all the interviews myself. I had to edit everything. And in Montana, when it's like snowing and there's 3 feet of snow, it's not always easy to be like holding a camera and doing an interview. And it's crazy. It's a lot going on.
It was
a little
summertime, right?
Exactly. So it gets a little overwhelming. But honestly, a friend of mine that I worked with there, he moved to New Hampshire, got a job. Producing, they needed someone else, and he called me and he just said, would you be interested in applying for the producing job? I just got curious, applied, got it, and I really wanted to move back to New England. This is definitely where I want to be. I'm from Connecticut, so this is just home to me. Came back, tried producing. I was in New Hampshire for about 7 months, and I loved it. It's totally different than reporting. Instead of focusing on one story for the day, you have, you know, 20, 30 little stories that you have to know a lot about, but you might only spend, you know, 20 seconds on that one story, and you have to decide, you know, what's more important than the other, and it has so much going on. I love it. I'm constantly busy, sometimes too busy, but it's great. I don't know if there's one that I like more than the other. I really miss reporting, but I feel like if I went back to reporting, I'd really miss producing. So I'm still young. I'm just going to kind of keep an open mind, see whatever pops up next. But I like producing right now. There's nothing about it I don't like, so I'll be doing that for a little bit, probably.
Thank you. And then our next question is for Sam. So Sam, your experiences include working for the digital departments in the local media outlets. So our question is going to be about the reliance on real-time news in the social media age. So what do you find more important, breaking the story first or getting all the facts and information right the first time? If any of you guys can also add to it.
That's a really relevant question right now, because
you're already seeing it on the broadcast side, especially in television, that rush to be first. And it honestly, you know, it's great to be the first one out there when you get the story right, but there's a lot of casualties that come with it. And it's the exact same thing you'll see in the digital side. If you get a number wrong, they'll say, you know, nothing, like, I can redo a story easily on the internet. I have the power to edit all day long. But those first initial eyes that see it are going to get the wrong information. And when you have several competing stations, so we're the only leading radio station, but our digital department, it's got to go toe-to-toe 12, 10, you know, everyone who has reporters on the scene. And if 3 out of 4 are getting something right, you're looking at your number and it's different, you really have to sit there and wonder what's going on. And especially in radio, when it's much smaller, there's a lot less people watching it. So there's a lot of pressure to get the right. I can actually give you a quick story about getting a number wrong. It was a situation where the governor was announcing a new and highly controversial, if you read local news, her highway tolling proposal for tractor trailer trucks. And we had a reporter on scene, and he'd sent back some audio of just something get on air very quickly. And I was monitoring Twitter, listening to what he was sending in. They'd given us a very initial press release, so we knew what was going on. It wasn't very number heavy, though. It had a few numbers, but it wasn't very number heavy. And as soon as the embargo lifted, I typed up what I had. I knew what was there was a solid story. I already had some quotes in there. Threw it up online. I think it's all good. The reporter comes back a few minutes later. He's only a few minutes away from the news station of this press conference happening. He looks at it and goes, all these numbers are wrong. And it had been up there for about 15 minutes, already up on social media. There's not a lot of take-backs at that point, especially when the number is in your headline and that was not correct. So that was quite the sobering experience, and I'll take the blame on a lot of it. It wasn't entirely my fault because there was a second press release that went along with the first one that I didn't get. But it's one of those situations where if you don't have that right, you get laughed at. And you don't ever want to be the laughingstock, especially if you're this young, scrappy news team or you've got something to prove and you're trying to demonstrate to somebody you're worth it. You don't want to get things wrong. So I'm going to say that, you know, as long as you got it up on the digital side, if you have a story up within 10 minutes of the other person, but all your facts are straight, all your periods are in the right spot, punctuation's flawless, then I'm saying that's a better story.
If I could just, can I just expand on that? In this world that we live in now that I didn't have when I was your age, first started in the business, and you guys can probably, is the internet and Twitter and all these things that you have people who aren't necessarily, and bloggers that aren't necessarily journalists fact checking or putting things out there that, you know, you tend to believe everything you read, and sometimes it's not the case. So if I'm sitting on the anchor desk at 6:30 tomorrow morning and I'm on my phone, you know, looking at Twitter, Facebook, and I see something pop on from, I don't know, Johnny Sixpack in Cranston saying there's a 10-car pileup on 95, I'm not going to go, hold on, we have breaking news, everybody, there's a 10-car pileup on 95, because I saw it, it has to be true, it's on Twitter, you know? So if you're going to be first, that's fine, be right. There's a big thing there. You got, like, a quick example is a couple months ago, James Skeffington, who was the kind of the driving force behind the Red Sox, the Paw Sox, trying to build that stadium in downtown Providence. I went to high school with his son. Okay, so I know Jim, and I'm from Barrington originally. So he died. And I got the call, a text that Jim Skeffington is dead. And I said to my friend, you know, okay, well, how do you know? Well, he's a cop in Barrington, and he found the body. He was jogging on a golf course in Barrington and dropped dead. So this, I have this information, and I tell my news director, you know, Jim Skeffington's dead. And she goes, well, how do you know? I said, because my buddy's a cop in Barrington. He just told me because he was there. All right, well, let's make sure. Now, he could have sent me a picture if he wanted to, but he didn't. But I had it, like, beyond a reasonable doubt, this guy was as dead as it gets. But until it was checked by, like, 2 or 3 sources, including, like, Larry Lupino, we couldn't report it because that's one of those things, you know, you don't want to just say, that's got a buddy in Barrington, he's a cop. And not that he would, you know, try and trick me into something as serious as this, but that's the point, is that you got to be extra careful. And you'll see that throughout your career. It's so tempting to see something and be like, oh, this has got to be true. And then, you know, if you get burned on TV, it's okay if Johnny Sixpack and Cranston gets burned, but if he gets burned or I get burned, or any people that are reporting it that you rely on, they're going to stop relying on you and they're going to stop watching.
Yeah, it's something I deal with every day, just producing live TV. Cole station, you know, WCBB, I might see something pop up on her station during my show that we don't have, and I'll be freaking out. You know, we need this on. You know, you want to compete with them, but I can't just go with the facts that they have, because that's not our info. Or vice versa, you know, you guys might see something, or Fox, or, you know, WBZ might see something. You have to always be aware of what the other stations are doing, but you can't go off it. Same with the newspaper, Twitter, anything. You have to be aware of it, but you have to confirm it first. There have been stories at any of the stations I've worked at that, you know, we've heard about, and it could take hours before you have it confirmed.
It's frustrating, too.
Yeah,
it's like, I know it's true.
Especially because I produce weekend mornings also. It's me and one of the producer for a few hours until our assignment manager arrives. So, I mean, we can make calls and stuff, but the chance of you getting some info on, you know, an accident or something like that, or some big legal case at 2 a.m. on Saturday is not likely. So you can't just go off, you know, what you see on Twitter or what I see on a different station. It's hard, but you just kind of have to deal with it, and you have to make sure your facts are right. Because if you don't, there goes all your credibility.
Absolutely. Thank you. Does anybody else have anything they want to add on that topic?
I just want to say, it's sort of on the topic, but also I think the main thing, like, we want to make sure the facts are right, and we want to make sure that we're first to get it out there. But what I notice, and I got to give it up to you guys, like, so much credit, because on BuzzFeed or these other blogs, everything, like, there's always a word missing, the headlines are always spelled wrong, there's always something, and it's just, you really need that extra second to look it over. It's like there aren't editors anymore, but so the news, like, they work so hard to make sure. I do a weekly show, so I have a little bit more time than, you know, a couple of hours to get a story out. But it's just so important to look it over and make sure everything sounds right, because a wrong number is huge. But so is just, you know, just poor, again, I guess I'm big on grammar. But like bad grammar, bad spelling. I mean, it's credibility that is so important to us as journalists.
You know what's crazy about this whole thing is TMZ, you know, we laugh at TMZ, They're always right. Like, as crazy as they are, like, they told me Michael Jackson died. They told me, you know, all these crazy, and you think, like, it's like they're almost in the room when this happens, right? I mean, it's amazing that you think about, like, credible sources, and for a while, TMZ, you're like, what, are these people out of their minds? You know, it's like, no way, but they've built up such, they've kind of, right? I mean,
sources are so
it's unbelievable, yeah. They're everywhere. Like, it's almost like they've got the doctors in the operating room, like, Lamar Odom just OD'd on cocaine. You know, it's crazy, but it's true. Like, and so that's one of those things where you're like, no, they can't be right. But they've built it up, and they've kind of gotten away from that reputation of being just a, you know, throw it out there and hopefully it sticks. So it's really amazing to turn. So that's just one example of that was, you'd look at them before, like 10 years ago, and be like, no way, Harvey. No way is that true. Now you're like, Harvey's on it. You know, I'm talking about Harvey, the guy that runs the show, Harvey. Anyway,
all right, let's go on to the next question. Thank you guys for all those responses. Those were great. All right, our next question is for Chris H. Chris, so you're reporting on issues of poverty and injustices happening around the world. Do you have any advice on how to report delicately on these sensitive matters?
Yes. We spend a lot of time thinking about this, despite the fact that we're not a news organization. We believe that one of the best ways for people to understand some of the complicated issues that we're working on is by taking what we call the narrative approach. What we found in studying our donors and the U.S. public is that very few of them would really understand what our organization does, but they do remember the stories we tell them about people who are involved in the projects. The narrative is extremely powerful, and it's an approach that people have taken for centuries, eons, you know. We remember stories. Now, we want, as we're just talking about, you know, the stories have to be right. The facts have to be straight, and you need to check things. And I think what we've been talking about here just now is when you're working on, it's a slight digression, when you're working with a team of people, you need to have a shared mental model about what standards you're going to apply. If you hear that somebody's dead, you can get it from a personal source, you can get it from the police, and then you can get it from the family, and maybe, you know, you need it three ways. I don't know. I mean, so everybody has to agree on when you're going to go out with someone. So some of the standards that we work with are what we call informed consent, where I go and I meet meet with people, and this is one of the difficult things about working across cultures and languages that I was describing before, most of the people I meet with don't know what the internet is. They, you know, if they do, they're, it's a little bit easier, but I try to explain to them that, you know, who I'm writing for, what I want to do, and I get their permission. And some of the stories that I write are about very grave human rights violations and terrible injustices. What I've found is that the people who are most willing to share their story are the ones who have been involved in some kind of a project that we've been funding, particularly domestic violence survivors, women in El Salvador and Guatemala, particularly where we have a very well-established program, who have been working with our partners. It's not work that we're doing. We're funding local people to do the work because we feel that that's the best way to build a sustainable solution to a problem of poverty or injustice. But anyway, we try to work with people who have been involved in some kind of a project because they have gone through an experience where they learn about their basic rights, they learn about their value as a person, and then they sort of change their perception about who they are and their place in the world. And usually when they get to that point, they want to talk. Even to some guy from Warren, Rhode Island, no idea who this guy is. If I can go in there with somebody they know, and I can sit down with them and explain to them what I'm trying to do and how I want to use what they're giving me, I can usually get a pretty good outcome. There are people that I speak with who don't really understand where I'm coming from, and they don't give me consent. So I sometimes negotiate, you know, can I talk about your story and not use your name? And we have some certain standards around that. We look at situations of vulnerability, people in situations where there's a low degree of accountability in regard to the state. And we may find, I may decide, you know, this person's in a very vulnerable situation. If somebody saw this story on the internet and decided to persecute this person, they could lose their life, they could lose their job, they could have all sorts of things happen to them. And I sometimes, you know, even though they're giving me permission, I just think, you know, I don't think they understand really what the stakes are here. So I've killed stories myself that I've actually reported and seen them come up on the internet, the equivalent of the TMZ, you know, where I see the person later, I'm like, well, I hope they know what they're doing because, you know, it's serious. I don't like to mess with people's lives, but, so anyway, I have criteria that I try to apply, which I can go through in more detail if anybody's interested.
All right, absolutely. I'm sure some people will come and talk to you again after the panel. So our next question is for Patrick. So every morning you're anchoring live TV news for hours on end. What is your daily work routine like? As you mentioned before, you get in every morning at 3 a.m. So what are you doing from then on until when you get on TV? And what is it like when there's breaking news happening while you're live on TV? Like, what's going on in your earpiece?
Well, it's the producer talking, and they basically just ignore them. And just babble and babble and babble, and they yell. Right? You just screw
exactly
up the entire timing of their entire show. Especially myself and Danielle North, my co-anchor, we just get into these giggle fits sometimes. We just can't control ourselves. But the day starts at 2:55 when the first alarm goes off. That one gets thrown to the ground. Then the phone alarm goes off at like 2:59. The first one, that's a snooze. And then 3:02, the second one goes off and I actually wake up. For some reason, I think if I get another 4 minutes of sleep, it's going to like just drastically change my day. I don't know. Snooze is a bad thing. But so I get to work. I get up. You all know what happens when you get up, get ready, you know. I get to work at like about 3:35 is a good day if I get there at 3:35. And the producers that write the show have been there since probably 11 o'clock at night. And they do all the writing, and us lazy prima donna anchors roll in, and we look at the scripts, and we proofread them, and we say, why aren't we doing this story? And they go, oh, here they come. Because we're the producers, and we know what's right, and we just get out there and read the stuff.
Sure.
Right. So you read through some scripts, get dressed, because I usually go to work in like, you know, the summertime, literally like shorts, flip-flops, and a t-shirt, and just bring a suit with me and get dressed. And yes, I do put makeup on, and I do it myself. That stays with student in this room, okay?
Can you delete that from that tape?
Sure.
That's not serious. Well, yeah, that, I those high def cameras, I'm telling you. I don't know if that's high def, but everything, you know. I'm 43, it makes me look like I'm 143. So then I just keep, you know, so we're on the air, we are on the air at 4:30. We start live TV at 4:30 a.m. Most, that's probably when most of you are coming home, right? College students, right? Shutting down about 3:45. Let's just have one more. No, it's the news is coming on. Let's stay awake. but we actually start taping things about 4:10. The cut-ins that you see, like on the national news, were like three top stories and the quick weather thing. And then I'm on TV from 4:30 a.m. until 9, straight through. There's breaks for weather, and when the weather's on, anchors like to wander around. So I don't know if they let them wander much where you are.
Well, I don't like to let them wander.
Right.
But they do it anyways.
Well, we do have to go to the bathroom.
Yeah,
so we,
true.
You know, wander around. 4:30 to 7 is on WPRI, which is CBS, and from 7 to 9 is on Fox. And right, throughout the course of the morning, there are times when there's, well, that's a long time to be on TV, first of all. So there's always things changing and evolving and breaking news. We have this little earpiece that is called an IFB, where the producers can talk to us and tell us, oh, listen, we just got a story about blah, blah, blah. That's going to be coming up at the end of this block. And a lot of times we won't have a script in the teleprompter. We read the teleprompter most of the time. You know, when you see us on TV, and it looks like we've got it memorized, we're really smart, we're reading. We're reading like little words. I'm sure you're all familiar with this, you know. You're old enough to understand them. Sometimes when there's breaking news, there's no teleprompter. It's like, all right, here's the deal. Three alarm fire, Warwick, two people injured, firefighter might be killed. We're working to get the angle on that story. You're going to go on in 30 seconds and say it. So, I'm like, write this down. And then the next thing you know, you're on camera and you got to deliver what he just told me or the producer just told me and make it make sense and deliver it. And, 20 years ago, I sounded like a bumbling idiot when I tried to do breaking news on the air. Now I've got a better grasp on what I need to say, how slow I need to say it, the facts that I need to get out there. And hopefully you're relying on the producer to give you all the information you need, because and this is a big thing about TV, is nobody sees them, right? They only see me or Danielle or the other news anchors. If I get it wrong, or if there's information wrong, and if he gave me the right information, either way, if I get it wrong and I can't say, well, the producer told me it was wrong, I got news for you. They don't care, they care about it, but we care about them. But the people at home don't know that I got that information usually from someone that's telling me they're here. So I've got to rely heavily on the producer. Without the producers, we are useless as anchors. I mean, that's the bottom. You know about being on TV and being behind the scenes.
Yeah.
That it's like they're literally like the big net underneath the high wire act of the circus. That we need them, and that's why at like Christmas parties we buy new gift cards to 1776 Liquors, and we get food gift certificates and take good care of them because we rely so much on them. So I hope that answered the question, but that's sort of a.
And then, Chris, is there anything you want to add to that, being on both ends of that spectrum?
Yeah, I mean, just from a day-to-day aspect, my day is pretty similar to Patrick's. I mean, I do the 9 a.m. news, so I usually show up around between 2 and 3 a.m. I have a little leeway. I'm tired, I'll sleep until 3, and I'll just work that much harder when I get in. But I actually know, even though I do the 9 o'clock show, I help out the 5 and 6 a.m. show before I start building my rundown for the day. I'll help them out. If they need something written or if they need some video cut, I'll sort through that for them. If there's breaking news, I'll try to help them out, and then I'll start on my show. But it's like Patrick said, it's a true team effort. And I don't think a lot of people realize that until you work in the business. Like you said, without the producer, the anchors are nothing. Without the anchors getting the facts right and doing what we ask them to do, it won't look good on air. When breaking news comes in, like you said, I might only tell them, three or four words, but they will talk for a minute or 2 minutes sometimes, or I'll just say, hey, we have Sky 7, our chopper up over a car accident, two car accident, cars on fire, talk. And they'll just talk for like 2-3 minutes.
Well, there's a car on fire.
Yeah, exactly. It's just, they'll go off the media and just talk.
Everybody's okay.
Yeah, exactly.
But like, for example, like when the Boston Marathon bombings thing was going on, I mean, we were literally like, almost as much as Boston TV stations were, but we were on, when they were looking for the two brothers, the day, well, we knew one was dead, the older one, but when they were looking for Johar, remember that whole day? It's like, we were on TV for like 8 hours straight. And when I say the breaking news is the best time for all of us, I think, anyway, if you're in the business, you just, let me say this right, it's usually a bad thing, right? It's a tragedy of some sort, which sucks, but it gets our juices flowing. That's not something that's not bad, but an interesting, or a day-changing story. I would much rather do that for 8 hours than sitting on the seat and look at the camera and talk about, a two-alarm fire in Fall River overnight, everybody's fine. There was a fender bender on Westminster Street in Providence last night. One person was arrested. They do that for 4 hours. I mean, like, really, like, it's just awful. Snowstorms, I love. We're on the air for 4 hours, right? We're on Armageddon, the rain over here. Oh, we just had no scripts, just wait, you know. You go to the reporter out in the snow. How was it out there? Captain Obvious reporting for duty. It's cold, and I'm miserable, and I want to be where you are, sitting at an anchor desk. Right? This sucks, but you can't say that on TV. But so the whole breaking news aspect of it, like the play-by-play, it's like live TV. I love it. I much rather do that. What was the question again?
You answered it. All right.
Now I've been up since 3, so get a little looper.
We're going to go on to one last question with Nicole before we open it. Open the questions up to the audience for the last 10 or so minutes. So Nicole, you are working as a producer for CityLine, and you also said that you are working under the umbrella of community affairs. Can you just give us an idea of what your day-to-day schedule is looking like with all that you're incorporating into one day?
No day is the same, but I think we can all say that. No day is the same. Probably the busiest day is on Wednesday week, so we're a weekly show. We air on Sundays, but we're live to tape, so we tape our show on Wednesdays. So we're a talk show, so the guests come in the morning. We get them all situated, make sure they know what they're going to talk about, and then it's kind of just getting the flow of the show happening within the hour that we have our studio booked. I am not the host, thank God, but I have to make sure that my host, Karen, you know, knows everything that she needs to talk about. She's prepped, she goes over the script, you know, usually lets me know right before we record what changes she wants to make. The director is usually yelling at me because I probably did something wrong, but that usually varies. And then if I have interns, if I'm lucky to have interns, they're usually the ones that are kind of facilitating, getting the guests in and out, just making sure that they're comfortable and making sure the conversation flows. So our show is half an hour long, we have 3 segments. And like I said, it's a talk show. So you have to think, if you do the math right, that's about 7 minutes per segment to talk to someone. And I highly doubt that any of you would ever be interested in that because we can't watch anything that's longer than like a minute and a half. So we have to make sure it's really interesting. We have to make sure that we can incorporate video. We like to try and find if it's, you know, if we're talking about a local story, news data package that might be relevant to us, we try to incorporate that as well. If they have video that they can supply, we want to make sure that we can incorporate that. So it's a lot of coordinating and figuring out where the conversation needs to go, but also we specifically cater to communities of color in the greater Boston area. So now our content really has to be focused. It really has to be local and specific to a target-focused audience. So most of the time during the week, we're doing a lot of research based on what's going on. If there's something national, we just did basically a whole show about social justice and social media and Black Twitter and Black Lives Matter. So we have to kind of take those national talking points and bring them into a local angle. So we're doing that a lot. And then I'm also making sure that the interns who produce their own half-hour show, so if you want to be an intern for CityLine, they're constantly making sure that, you know, all their show material is prepared, because that's basically a semester-long process. And then they're also helping me with the other things that I have to do. So that's kind of CityLine in a nutshell. And then under the community affairs umbrella, which CityLine is under, I'm also working with nonprofits. So all the PSA intake and inventory, that usually filters through me as well as Karen. I'm making sure that it's going to traffic and that it's getting placed in the right places, and the priorities are sent out to the Creative Services Department. And then if we're working with any walks, so if, you know, the ALS Association has a walk, I have to make sure that they have the proper materials from us, that we have developed a PSA for them, that it's airing, and I think that's it. Oh, like web stuff. So, you know, take the content from the show that airs on Wednesday, break it down to 30 seconds or less, because I think no more than like 25 seconds, like I'm not allowed to do it. Put it on social media only, and then we can kind of promote the show that way. So that's great. So it varies from day to day, but I think everyone up here can say the same.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much for all of your thoughtful responses to my questions. And now I would love to open up the audience to ask questions to any of the panelists. Just raise your hand if you have a question to ask. John, back there.
Has Twitter and the digital age made it hard as journalists and reporters to gather information?
Harder?
Not just in terms of like accuracy.
Oh yeah, that's the biggest challenge, like I said. Yeah, like, well, just for A lot of the Twitter stuff is amazing in how it's changed, is that we used to wait, dating myself, but like the morning newspaper was like the breaking news of the day, like that, you know, so you'd get that with the evening newspaper. And it's amazing how it's evolved from, and I speak mostly for television, where you would hold the story, right? You'd hold the story that you get at like noon for the 5 o'clock newscast. Where now, you get the story at noon and it's on at 12:01. There's no more holding the story. So it's changed the game. The internet has totally changed the game that I got into when I first started, because there was no internet. There was no phones, there was no electricity. There was no cars, airplanes,
buggers.
Joking, I lost you there.
Really?
Yeah.
I wonder if it was hard for you to adjust.
Well, it was at first, because of that reason I said before, that like the accuracy point, like you get the thing on Twitter and this thing's like, what's this Twitter thing? Like, what's this thing all about? Why did this guy, is this true, right? So, you know, it's made it different. Harder, it's more of a challenge to get to be as accurate, because it's not always accurate, I think. And I don't want to blame Twitter.
Like, I don't know the days before all, you know, cell phones. Like, my complete professional career has been with Twitter and all that. But even when I was in Montana, they're not big on Twitter out there. You know, if a huge car accident happens, yeah, exactly. You're not going to see it on Facebook or Twitter first. You know, you're going to have to go there personally. So going from there to Boston, where, you know, there's a car accident or something, it's on Twitter, Facebook within seconds sometimes. So it's both easier and harder. It's easier to get the info, you know. If I have info on a story, maybe I can get a picture to go along with it on Twitter by asking for permission. But it also makes it harder, because, again, you have to ask permission, you have to check the facts.
Yeah. Yeah. Everything's sped up, right? Everything's sped up. Now, I think about, like, what you know, like what you guys do, where it's more of, you know, I say you can take your time doing it, because there's no such thing as us taking our time. It's like, we get it out and it's over. Whereas you're doing a show that you tape on Wednesday that airs on Sunday, and we're doing, you know, it's live bullets and we're flying, and you do stuff that takes weeks and weeks.
Yeah, I use Twitter. I started using Twitter a couple of years ago, and I follow people, and I'm trying to keep track of some pretty obscure stories that most, you know, like you guys aren't going to be reporting on, and, you know, cases related to indigenous people, conflicts with, you know, mining operations in the far western highlands in Guatemala. Now, I know there's reporters around there, because I met them when I was there, so I follow these guys on Twitter, and when stuff starts to happen, I get it from them. Now, I don't write that like that day, but, you know, over periods of time, I just sort of try to keep track. You know, I was a little over a year ago reporting on a case of human rights violations in this case near Guatemala City. And there was a guy who, one of my sources who was in Washington last week testifying in Congress and doing some other meetings. So I interviewed him, and I've got a story in the works that I'm hoping to get out either Friday or next week. And so there's a few people who I follow in Guatemala who I know are following this story. So Twitter helps me a lot, because I can't be everywhere. But, you know, but I'm finding sources who are just all over the place. People in Cambodia, people in Mali. There's like this crazy war that's been going on in the north and like eastern parts of Mali that none of us have heard about. And I'm following reporters who are in that area, and I'm, you know, keeping track, because I'm trying to get back there, and I know it's not safe. So I'm kind of waiting and watching what they're tweeting about to try to get a grip on what's happening. It's an incredible news resource, I'm finding, yeah.
The only thing I'm saying now, like what you're going to do now, going into the internet, and there was no, there was no internet when I first started TV, because there wasn't. It's almost taken over as, I don't want to say a more important thing than the actual, what I do, the TV news broadcast, but the internet is 24/7. I'm just waiting for them to tell me that I can be on TV for 24 hours a day. No, I don't want them to. Right. But you know what I mean? Like the internet, you can always, right, here it, wherever, here it is. Oh, you know, so what he's going into at Channel 10 is more immediate and more like right now than even more the right now stuff that I do every day and what he does every day, right? I mean, so you really got to be accurate. There's more
exactly.
rules, I think, for the internet than there are for broadcast, but anything on TV.
It's really one of those things where if you are obviously represent the brand. When you go to work for any news institution, you represent the brand of that building. And if you're putting out information that's wrong, obviously that reflects on the station. So that you have to be very, very careful when you're the one putting information out on social media. But in terms of, I think your question, like news gathering itself, depends on what form of news gathering you're looking at. If this is more of the standard, like Fender Bender, Fire, you know, a lot of the time people have phones, they have pictures, and they're tweeting about it. That's a good indicator that you need to send, like, at least a photographer, or if it's an AM shift, it's, you know, overnight, send a stringer out to go get some video. And then you'll have something for your newscast. It gets a little more complicated when you're talking about a more complicated issue. Let's say in the event of, for example, Jim Skeffington, if someone tweeted that, and we didn't get, then you didn't get that tip from a text message. That's extremely dubious. It's you know, you already have to go through enough filters of people when it's a direct source. Now you're looking at social media, you have to be very, very careful what you're getting. And then again, unless it's that pic, and you can't even count if it's a picture on the ground, because, you know, in the age of Photoshop, anything can be fake. So it depends on what you're looking for. If you're looking for that hard news, if you're looking for something very data-driven, you're getting tweets from a non-reputable source, it's like 10-foot pole, don't touch it. But if it's the more conventional day-to-day news, a week or so ago, there was a small Black Lives Matter protest that involved a Dunkin' Donuts coffee mug or something like that. So a worker wrote on it. There was actually a protest that happened outside of a Dunkin' Donuts. It broke on Twitter, and then we went and sent people there to recover it. But in instances like that, it has, obviously, it's pros and cons.
All right, thank you. And I think we have time for one more question. Does anybody have anything you'd like to ask? Yeah.
So obviously you love your job, because you're saying that, like, it's really exhilarating, it's fantastic. But is there an out? Like, are you chained to your desk, or can you go leave and do something else at some point?
Me?
Yeah, anybody.
I am a desk jockey. I don't move. I shouldn't say that. I mean, I go, when I did sports, I traveled a lot. Now that I'm the morning news anchor, I get out sometimes and do things. We're called active anchors sometimes. We'll go out with a special piece, not live day of, but it'll air like I did one. This one blew my mind. There's this powdered caffeine stuff. I mean, what are you kids doing? Like, I mean, seriously, like, right? Have you heard of this stuff? No? Good. But anyway, I'm doing a story. I went out as an anchor, right, an active anchor, do this powdered caffeine story that people are taking, like, thinking it's like Kool-Aid mix, and they have, like, one teaspoon is like having 700 cups of coffee. So, like, kids that want to get, like, a jolt to go work out, like, will do, like, a little tiny teaspoon, put it in their water, and drink it, and just die. And you can get this at GNC. So that's, like, a story that I'll have coming up in November. It's called a sweeps piece, right? It's like a boost the ratings so people watch, like, here's how not to die. Watch Patrick, Tuesday night at 6. But so I get out sometimes, but for the most part, no, I'm stuck to that desk. But I travel a lot with sports, and I'm fine with it now. Like, I've been doing this, you know, 21 years, and I've kind of worked my way up to it. Being an anchor isn't like, it's not like it's a, oh, change the desk, it's not a bad thing. It's kind of a, it's like, not the pinnacle of my side of the business, but it's pretty close, I guess, if you're going to, you know, strive to be something.
All right, we actually have one more question before we wrap
it
up.
I'm taking up all the time.
Professor Prado?
Yeah, I'm wondering if the panelists could speak just very briefly to wrap up about what it is that they wish they had done more of in college before they went out into the real world, or what is it that they did do, you know, that they really wish they could maximize before heading out looking for that first gig.
Internships. I was the kid that had, I didn't have a McDonald's on my resume, but I was the kid that was more focused on working and making money to go to the bar. But, you know, not pay off all those loans on the average. But I was more focused on making money and working part-time than using that time to go and do that grunt work and have experience that was unpaid. So, I mean, I went to Northeastern, so we had the call-up program, so it was a little bit more, kind of got forced into the internships because it was part of the curriculum, but the internships are so important, and it's finding that balance between making that money and not making that money, because, like I said, you're not going to make money as an intern. So just find that balance and have the internships. It's all about that resume and making those contacts also. The networking is so important. So those are the people you will speak to, and they'll be able to vouch for you later if your work is good.
And did anyone else want to add to that?
Yeah, I'd say internships. Kind of the opposite, Nicole. I did a lot of internships. I did 3 in college, and kind of wish I did more. Like, I had so much fun doing them. It's what really proved to me that I love this business. Just do as many as you can. Like Nicole said, contacts. Two of my references when I applied for my first job were from my first internship, and they just put in the great work for me. And actually, I remember Professor Prada, I went to her and Professor Scully when I was applying jobs, and I said, will you guys be a reference? And they said, absolutely, but it's going to look a lot better if you have somebody who, you know, works at a station right now or something like that. And I think it's true. As good as that recommendation would be, you know, the news director of, say, an NBC affiliate puts in a good work for you, it's going to look good because they're in the business right now. Do those internships, stay in touch with people. I still email people who I interned with, even though I haven't seen them in years. So do that. They're fun. I mean, you don't get paid. It sucks, but they're fun.
I would say maybe half the people that are the TV station that are there now, at whatever department, whether it be photographer or engineer or director, even not so much reporters because it's a larger market, but although Steph will be reporting for us when she graduates in next May.
Oh,
really? Congratulations, you got the job. But I'm just pointing is that interns, like, you look around the room at our TV station, in our newsroom, and the producers, whatever, and a lot of these people, like, wait a second, weren't you an intern here like 4 or 5 years ago, right? And now you left and went and got a job somewhere, you know, in Montana, and then you're back. My only regret is that I went from Manchester, New Hampshire, right to Rhode Island, which was great at the time because I'm from Rhode Island and I didn't have to go all over, but I wish that I had a chance when I was younger to do more of like go and get a job for a couple of years in like a city that I've never been to. You know, don't be afraid to explore, and you know, you might be from, say you're from, I don't know, you say you're from Boston, you want to be a TV reporter in Boston. Well, don't be afraid for the first 10 years of your career to go work in Phoenix and in Denver, and then, you know what I mean, or Miami. Like, if you can get those chances to bounce around and see parts of the country, right, you might.
Yeah, it's totally worth it. It's terrifying, and you don't know what, you know, what's in store for you, but it's so worth it. I don't regret anything about it. You know, like I said, this is where I want to work and live now, but I've gotten to see something. If you have the opportunity, just do it. Try it out.
I would go to Haiti and get stuff there.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually a good point. If you want to do international reporting, it's good to travel. It's good to learn languages. It's good to... kind of what you're saying about working in other markets, it's good to study someplace or something interesting, even if you don't pursue that as your life's work, it shows that you have facility to become an expert in something. And I think that's important. I think, you know, languages are very important. I am constantly in situations where I think to myself, I should have studied anthropology. You know, I think it would have been so interesting because of all the different kinds of people I'm meeting, you know, I think it would help me ask the right questions. So I talk to a lot of anthropologists and I read a lot of interesting stuff now, but I often think that I should have studied that in school. I think for international reporting, you know, it's good to get out. It's good to go places and meet people and like I said, study over.
All right, well, that concludes our media panel. Please stick around for our networking reception.